Go to Campbell and John, because they're looking closely at this very important balance of power in Congress.
And we have more toys to share, I think. Obi-Wan, let's take a look. What better, if it works, here, John.
All right, Campbell.
What better visual do we have to talk about balance of power than we have our virtual capital, maybe?
We're going to bring the virtual capital in. No. See, you have to trust me.
You have to trust me. Your fingers.
Sorry, these come over here. You guys, we're going to try to take a closer look at the balance of power. And as we do so, Campbell looks a little lonely at that table. So let's see what we can do to help her out there. Look at that.
Very impressive.
And the big fight, of course, as Wolf just outlined, going through those battleground Senate races, is the battle for the Senate. So let's give you a little board up there where you can see the fight for the Senate right now. And what we're going to do here is we're going to take these races here, and we see what's on the board. If it's filled in the middle, that means we have called it. You look at those states up there where you see white in the middle of the tiles. Those are your key races. And Wolf was just talking about one of them. It looks like Georgia incumbent Saxby Chambliss right now is running in the lead. The key question there, can he get over 50%? We'll continue to watch the results there. Otherwise, there is a runoff. That is one of the races the Democrats had hoped Campbell to win if they can get to 60, but we'll keep watching that one. Saxby Chambliss in the lead at the moment. A critical race that we have to wait a while to see, the Alaska Senator Ted Stevens. He is the longest-serving Republican in the United States Senate, convicted just last week of 7 corruption charges. The Democrats believe the Anchorage mayor will win this race, but a long way to go before we're counting the votes in Alaska, so we'll wait on that one. Here is what Wolf was just talking about. Democrat Mary Landrieu is the vulnerable Democrat, the only vulnerable Democratic incumbent. We're watching the vote count in Louisiana. A big factor there. We've talked about the African-American vote coming out for Obama all over the country. The post-Katrina population. This is the first time we're getting a good look at that in a presidential race, and the African-American population down a bit there. This, of course, another race many people are watching. The former Saturday Night Live writer and comedian Al Franken, now a liberal radio host, against Norm Coleman. This a key battleground race. I'm going to come back, leave this race up. If you look right there, you see 54 right now for the Democrats, 36 for the Republicans. You go through these races, and one the Democrats do expect to win is this race out in Colorado. We're waiting for more races there, but I'm going to hypothetically give this one. Remember, hypothetically, give this one to the Democrats and say that gets them up. You see the numbers up there to 55. It's getting hard to get to 60, and that is the key issue. Assume, for the sake of argument, Al Franken holds this out. And again, this is a hypothetical at home, folks. The other party doesn't like it when you start giving these away. But even if you do that one, that's 56. Assume that Alaska race we talked about goes for the Democrats. That would be 57. It's getting very hard. Now, and if Mary Landrieu holds on, again, another if, we'll do that. That's a plausible way to get you to 58. The question now is, can you get to 60? There's a good race out in Oregon. Gordon Smith is the Republican incumbent. I heard Jeff, I think, talking about him earlier, saying he's essentially saying, I want to work with Barack Obama. We'll see how that one turns out. This is a difficult race for the Democrats. They were hoping former Governor Ronnie Musgrove could pull that one out. It looks like Senator Roger Wicker is holding on at the moment. We'll keep watching that. But the bottom line, Campbell, if you look here, 58, I can get the Democrats there without taking too many leaps of faith. It's hard to get to 60 when you look at these other races on the battle. And one other thing we want to show you, some of you might have noticed, if you're paying very close attention, we have a yellow ring around this Connecticut tile. This is Joe Lieberman. He is not on the ballot. The question is, will Democrats let him stay in their caucus? Because
I was going to say, to be counting Joe Lieberman as part of the 60 seems a little bit ridiculous, given some of the things he's been saying about Barack Obama and Sarah Palin over the last few weeks and the way he campaigned for John McCain.
There are many Democrats who, regardless of the number, would like to kick Joe Lieberman out of their caucus. That's what would happen if they did, or if he chose to leave the caucus. Then you would flap. Well, you could watch there. If you watch that number, we could do this. Joe Lieberman stays with the Democrats. Or this, if Joe Lieberman goes with the Republicans. That will be a question I suspect will not be answered tonight, but will be answered between now and January when the new Congress comes in. But this is what we're going to watch throughout the night. And again, pretty easy to get the Democrats up to 57, 58. They would need a wave out in the western states in some races they're not expected to win to get to the 60 number. Still, it looks like, without a doubt, the Democrats will have a bigger majority in the Senate. We also expect, and we haven't focused much about it, but I'll switch and show the House lineup. We also expect a bigger majority in the House. This is the current lineup in the House, 236 for the Democrats, 199. Those races come in a little more slowly because our focus is on the presidential race and on the Senate races, but you can expect a bigger majority in the House and a somewhat bigger majority in the Senate. 60 looks like it might be a tad out of reach at the moment, but we got a lot of votes to count still.
And for those people who have been worried about the possibility of one party controlling Congress and the White House, the last president to do that, of course, was?
That was Bill Clinton. And
Jimmy Carter. Jimmy Carter. Bill Clinton had Democrats in the House and in the Senate?
Very briefly.
Very briefly. didn't go so well.
No, it didn't. There was a health care plan in 1992 out of the box, in 93 out of the box. And 1994 is the year Republicans are going to be thinking a lot about 1994 tonight as they look at this map and figure out how do we recover from what looks like is going to be a fairly devastating night for the Republican Party.
And we should say a lot of the races that John showed you, we have not called yet. So these are hypotheticals
right.
as we're trying to get to those numbers, and we'll be updating you as we have more numbers throughout the night. Let's go back to you, Wolf.
All right, thanks, Campbell. Thanks, John, very much. Remember, at the top of the hour, five more states will be closing, including California at stake. 81 more electoral votes. We'll see if we can make projections at the top of the hour. That will be interesting to see what's going on. You can go to CNN.com and do what John King was just doing. Take a look at those Senate races, those House races. If you have some specific interests, you want to see where they stand right now, go there. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back.
One of the biggest challenges for geoscientists is trying to find the oil and gas that's hidden below the surface of the Earth. Lately, our researchers have developed a new technology called R3M. You can't see it and you can't feel it, but the Earth has electromagnetic waves. And if you build the right kinds of listening devices, you can make sense of those waves. So using those tools, we can supply more of the energy that we need with less of an impact on the environment.
Discover Budweiser American Ale, brewed with Cascade hops and caramel malted barley for a full-bodied taste. Surprised? Don't be. New Budweiser American Ale.
Millions of people suffering from joint discomfort mask their pain using products with potential serious side effects.
My doctor recommended Cosamin ASU, which does more than just mask my pain.
Laboratory research shows that the ingredients in Cosamin ASU not only reduce inflammation, but also promote healthy joints. Side effects may include increased activity, better comfort, and improved quality of life. Don't rely on the mask. Take Cosamin ASU. Anything less just isn't the best.
A door is a door is a door, except when it's more of a portal. A portal to doing good. When you go through our doors, 5% of our income goes out and into your communities. That's $3 million a week for education, arts, and social services, which could open a lot of doors for a lot of people. Doing good is easy when doing good is automatic.
D.L. Hughley's new Saturday night show on CNN really breaks the news.
How many of you think that D.L. Hughley doesn't have what it takes to do this show?
That's cold.
D.L. Hughley breaks the news. CNN Saturday night, 10 Eastern.
CNN Tomorrow, a special extended edition of American Morning, the new president and how he won. CNN Tomorrow, a special extended edition of American Morning.
Get big arms, a ripped chest, and cut abs with the perfect push-up. Now with free shipping. The perfect push-up works with the natural rotation of your arms and shoulders to maximize results and minimize stress on your body. With the perfect push-up, your hands, arms, and shoulders rotate 90 degrees, just like in a punch. All the energy of the push-up is captured and transmitted right where you want it, to the muscles. There's no wasted effort, just muscle-building movement. And as your arms rotate, you feel it work in your biceps, your chest and abs, and your shoulders. Invented by a U.S. Navy SEAL and made with steel and a ball-bearing movement, it's the push-up perfected. So here's the deal. The perfect push-up is only two payments of $19.95. When you order, you'll receive two perfect push-up rotational handles, and you'll also receive the Navy SEAL-inspired perfect push-up workout chart. Call right now and you get free shipping. Get big fast. Call now for the perfect push-up.
Welcome back to this very exciting night. You're seeing a live picture of Grant Park in Chicago. Thousands of people assembled there awaiting Barack Obama, awaiting the final election results tonight on this night, which looks very good for Barack Obama at this point. As you can see, the crowds are excited. They are watching us at Grant Park there. You can see them reacting to the fact that they're being shown right now. Again, they are awaiting the arrival of Senator Barack Obama. There are a lot of luminaries in the crowd as well. We're joined now via hologram by will.i.am, who is live in Grant Park. Let's see if we can beam him in now. There we go. Will, thanks very much for being with us. How is this night for you?
Oh, this is great. You know, we're at the eve of a brand new day in America, and it feels good being here in Chicago. All this technology, I'm being beamed to you like it's Star Wars and stuff.
Yeah, it looks like basically like exactly like in Star Trek when they would beam people down. That's what it looks like right here.
But this is it's a beautiful time here. In Chicago, it's a beautiful time in Los Angeles. My mom texts me, telling me how proud she is of me and, you know, lending my career to inspire people to go out and vote and being the voice for young people.
We're doing this interview with you this way because it's a lot quieter than having you in that crowd. It's very hard to hear in this crowd, and we appreciate you being with us. You have been instrumental, really, in this campaign. You produced a video, which you performed in. You got a lot of other people to perform in, Yes We Can, that really got an enormous amount of play. How did you come up with that? How did that happen?
Well, when inspiration calls, you know, you answer it. And I was inspired by Barack Obama's speech in New Hampshire. And what I wanted to do is I wanted teachers to teach that speech in a school because I remember growing up reciting Abraham Lincoln's speech and Martin Luther King's speech and John F. Kennedy's speech. And I wanted that speech, the way it hit me, how it inspired me, I wanted kids to recite it in schools. So I turned the speech into a song and I put a melody to his words and called a lot of my good friends with the help of Pantera Sarah and Mike Jerkovic, who helped direct the video with Jesse Dillon, and we put that video and song together and put it up on the internet, and the rest is history.
There's so much division right now in this country. We're looking at the popular vote right now. It's very even in the popular vote, though Barack Obama is way ahead on the Electoral College map. After tonight, whoever wins, do you think this country can come together?
It's important that this country comes together, and it's important that the eyeballs that have been on this process, that we continue to stay involved in what happens to America. Just because the news doesn't cover it doesn't mean that we don't take responsibility in our own communities and our own schools to push so whoever is the president executes the things that they've promised since they've been campaigning.
Will.i.am, I appreciate you being with us tonight via hologram. Thanks very much. Have a great time tonight.
Thank you. Check it out.
All right. Got a lot more ahead, a lot more holograms ahead, and a lot more importantly, a lot more election results. We'll be right back.
You wanted it to work out here. You wanted it to work right now. You wanted free weekends and free hands. You wanted it to do more and cost less. You wanted your email, text messages, GPS, and MP3s, your favorite websites, your favorite colors. And tomorrow, you'll want even more. Okay.
Your dream home consultant. Your expert negotiator. Your expressway to tomorrow. Your internet listing guru, your condo connoisseur, your lighthouse to your house, your Century 21 agent. Now, more than ever, your path home. Century 21, the gold standard.
These aren't mine.
This is Bob at CDW. Leave a message.
Hey, Bob, it's Greg. Competition's starting to get a little too close, so we need to talk. Let's discuss network security. Call me. Hope you're well.
Hey, Greg. I'm here with your network and security specialist.
Greg, there are security updates for all your offices and some new features you'll like.
Perfect. Thanks, you guys.
With experienced technology specialists certified in everything from storage to security, CDW is there.
Greg, behind you.
That's pretty good.
Now you can enjoy music on your iPod with Bose Quality Sound, delivered by a small, elegant system that's portable. Introducing the new Bose SoundDock Portable Digital Music System. unplug it, and take it where you want to go for a performance unmatched by other battery-powered systems this small. So while your surroundings may change, the performance stays with you. The new Bose SoundDock Portable Digital Music System. Performance that's portable.
Closed captioning brought to you by RSM McGladrey.
What's behind success? RSM McGladrey, the accounting, tax, and business consultants for growing companies like yours. McGladrey, behind success.
Only one of these 10 people can be the CNN Hero of the Year. Vote now at CNN.com/heroes. Then join Anderson Cooper Thanksgiving night to see your choice.
Would you like to put a stop to your partner's snoring so you could go to sleep and stay asleep every night? Introducing Pure Sleep, the stop snoring solution. Common snoring is caused when the airway is constricted, causing the soft palate to vibrate. Pure Sleep is a patented self-molded mouthpiece cleared by the FDA, which holds the jaw slightly forward, opening the airway so that the snoring stops. Look at the difference in these before and after images.
That is just the astounding thing. I have not snored. And so this thing works. It's easy to use, easy to mold, works like a charm.
I'm sleeping through the night and so is he, and we're waking up with more energy and not waking up in the middle of the night to say shh.
If it doesn't work, we'll refund the purchase price, refund the original shipping charge, and even pay to ship it back. Try Pure Sleep risk-free.
Visit us at puresleep.com.
DLU Lead breaks the news. All new CNN Saturday night, 10 Eastern.
We're only 6 minutes away or so, 7 minutes away, Anderson, from the polls closing on the West Coast in California and four other states. 81 electoral votes. Potentially, we could be making some major projections at the top of the hour.
We also have views, images from really around the world where we are watching. People watching this around the world right now. There's a lot of excitement out
there. We have viewers here on CNN and CNN International in 240 countries around the world right now. Take a look. They're watching us in Sydney, Australia. There they are. They're watching what's happening here in the United States. A nice time difference, but they're applauding in Sydney. In Los Angeles, they're watching. They're getting ready to close the polls in California in a few minutes. We'll see if we can make a projection there. In New York, you're looking at this picture here. This is in Harlem, where there's a lot of excitement. Potentially the first African-American to be elected president of the United States. Very excited in Harlem. And look at this. They're even watching. There's a watching party in Kenya right now. Barack Obama's father, as all of our viewers know, he was from Kenya. Barack Obama went there, visited there. So they're rooting for Barack Obama in Kenya as well. All of this part of the international audience that's glued right now to see what happens here in the United States. Let's walk back to Anderson. He's got the best political team on television. They're watching it. They're glued to their TVs as well, Anderson.
We are. It's definitely getting close. I mean, we're now moments away from the 11 o'clock hour. It could be a very significant hour.
It is a witching hour. We've got California with 55. He's 63 away. California's got 55. He only needs 8 more. You got Washington, Oregon, Hawaii. Wouldn't it be particularly fitting if Hawaii was the state that put him over? Mm. His grandmother just died. It was, you know, it's so important to him as a state, so important to his origins. There's something really nice about that.
Bill Bennett, I know you have to take off at 11. Right. Your thoughts at this hour?
Well, it's been a very interesting campaign, hasn't it? Really, really interesting campaign. And, if Barack Obama wins the presidency, I will pray for Barack Obama. I will pray for this country. But, you know, John McCain could have taken an easy life, you know, after all he's been through. Could have lived with his wife and, you know, just celebrated the good life, the luxury life. Incredible obstacles he faced this year in this campaign. The electoral vote looks like it will be pretty one-sided. Looks like the popular vote may actually be pretty close. I just remember he said, I would rather lose an election than lose a war. Looks like he's about to lose an election. But thanks in large part to his efforts, looks like we're not going to lose a war. So just a salute to him. All the commentators, all the people commented on tonight, no one in the history of running for president has given more to his country than John McCain.
You know, September 2003, I'm at Congressional Black Caucus, and I'm walking around talking to people. And Anderson, really, this skinny guy with big ears, reaches out his hand and says, hey, I'm Barack Obama running for the U.S. Senate. At that time, there were no blacks in the U.S. Senate. And I was kind of like, okay, right. And then all of a sudden, to think 5 years later, that this guy clearly is about to give a speech as a president-elect of the United States, the 44th president, is stunning. It's absolutely stunning. The path that he has traveled, and it's amazing how he maintained himself from that period to now. It's truly stunning.
He couldn't get into the 2000 convention. He couldn't get on the floor, and he couldn't rent a car in 2000 convention. This happened in George Bush's America. May I just say that as a last comment? Kind of a joke, guys. Sorry.
Can I just say something? John McCain. If John McCain doesn't win tonight, as it looks like he won't, it will be the fifth consecutive presidential election where the candidate with the better war record lost. You know, when you think about military heroes as great politicians, as people, you know, 92, George Bush Sr., 96, Bob Dole, 2000, Al Gore, 2004, John Kerry, and now John McCain, all these war heroes, they get the nomination, but they don't win.
Generational
now,
change.
I don't know what conclusion to draw, but it is peculiar.
It is that we are no longer...
It's generational.
It's totally generational. Sure it is. And by the way, sure another thing that stood in John McCain's path was his age. I think when you look at these exit polls, in many ways sure, you can right. see, as Bill Schneider and Soledad said earlier, that age may have been more of a factor than race in this election. And I think when you have a younger electorate and you have a 72-year-old presidential candidate who chooses somebody that 60% of the people don't think is qualified to be vice president, should anything happen to him, you've got a problem there. But can I say something about John McCain? I've covered him for such a long time. He's an honorable man, and you're right, he could have found other things to do. He came back from the dead in his primary campaign, and he's somebody who fought this out, and it was a tough road, and he did not run a great campaign. Let's be clear about that. You would agree with me on that.
I'm sorry, we're gonna have a projection now, Wolf.
And this is a big one. Senator Barack Obama will carry the state of Virginia. This is an important win for Senator Obama. 13 electoral votes, 92% of the precincts in Virginia have now reported, and Senator Obama will carry the state. Right now, take a look at the actual vote. 51% for Obama, 49% for McCain. He's up by 61,820. That's with 92% of the precincts Virginia. It hasn't gone Republican in what, some 44 years since 1964. That was the last time Virginia went for a Democratic presidential candidate. It was for LBJ back in 1964. But now Virginia and its electoral votes, we project, will go for Barack Obama. We're only a few seconds away from the top of the hour when these states will be closing. And there are some big ones, especially California, the largest state in the United States with 55 electoral votes. Hawaii, that's where Barack Obama was born. It will be closing its polls. Idaho, Oregon, and Washington states, both of those states have been going Democratic in presidential contests in recent years. So in a few seconds, those states will be closing their polls, and presumably we'll be able to see what's going on and make perhaps a major projection at that point. This is a moment that a lot of people have been waiting for. This is a moment that potentially could be rather historic. And CNN can now project that Barack Obama, 47 years old, will become the president-elect of the United States. We project he now has enough electoral votes, more than 270, more than enough to become the 44th president of the United States. This little-known U.S. senator, only a few years ago, seemingly coming out of nowhere, delivering the Democratic Convention keynote address back at the convention in 2004, all of a sudden taking off, becoming a United States Senator from Illinois, and now he will be the first African-American president of the United States. This is a moment so many people have been waiting for, and they're really excited, especially in Chicago. Let's listen in for a moment. See the crowds, they are exhilarated right now, some 232 years after the Declaration of Independence. An African American, a black man, has been elected President of the United States. He will become the President-elect, and he will be inaugurated and sworn in on January 20th of next year. The hard work will really, really begin at this moment, but this is a moment right now that so many millions of people in the United States can celebrate, because Barack Obama will become the 44th president of the United States. Anderson?
Roland Martin, as you watch these pictures, as you think about this moment, your thoughts?
Obama's gonna be sworn in on January 20th, 2009. 2009 will mark the 100th anniversary of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. Obama got his start in politics in Springfield, Illinois. It was a race riot in Springfield, Illinois, that led to the creation of the NAACP.
Bill Bennett?
I think I said everything I want to say. I'll pray for him, pray for the country. Congratulations. It's a great country. It's a great country, and I hope he's a great president.
Davis?
Yeah, Anderson, I went back to look at the last speech that Martin Luther King gave back in 1968. It was the day before he died, but he was assassinated. And he said, "I just want to do God's will." And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain, and I've looked over, and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. And it seems to me, for an awful lot of people in this country, especially for African Americans, and Barack Obama said he's part of the Joshua generation, and Martin Luther King was our Moses, that we're much closer to that now. We haven't ended our prejudice, but there's something about this evening and this election that I think has made for an awful lot of people feel, you know, this is the Joshua generation. We can reach something we never thought we could reach 40, 50 years ago.
Well, I went and looked back at the Constitution,
yeah.
And the first sentence talks of our desire to form a more perfect union. We haven't done that, but we're still striving, and I think only the least gracious among us, no matter what your political philosophy, only the least gracious wouldn't say that this is a watershed moment for America.
Jeff? Last year I was lucky enough to go to Madrid with my family, and I went to the palace where the king always receives the president of the United States. It's one of these amazing European palaces. And I thought, what if Barack Obama is the symbol who walks through? What if he is the representative to the world of the United States? That is going to be such a transformational experience in terms of how the world sees us, that I don't know if we can really figure it out what it means at this point.
You know what, Andrew, African-American parents for years, when their children said, "I want to be a doctor, I want to be a lawyer, I want to be a politician, I want to be an astronaut," they always said, they could always point to an African-American who's achieved it. But whenever a kid said, "I want to be president," I literally saw black parents say, "Son or daughter, you may think of me something else." I have 9 nieces and 4 nephews, and when I talk to them, I can actually say that and mean it.
Bingo.
That's it. On the right-hand side of your screen, the images from Kenya, celebration there. We've been showing you images from around the world. Soledad O'Brien also watching the reaction here. Soledad, your thoughts?
We were doing our documentary, Black in America. It was amazing to have people think about the promise that a Barack Obama election could bring. People didn't even want to speak about it specifically in case it were not to happen. African Americans, of course. There are so many issues in Black America, some of which we looked at, and his election will not solve those issues overnight. But what a symbol it sends, as Jeff said, outside this nation and then inside this nation, the promise of how great America can be to all Americans, all of us, with the election, with the step forward of this one man. I think African Americans see this as such a historic and important moment. It's an incredible night.
Well, Martin, as you look at these pictures, you're an Obama supporter. Do you wish you were there tonight?
No, because I think about Vernon Jarrett. I think about Frederick Douglass. I think about Ida B. Wells, Barnett. These were some of the most historic Black journalists. Their job was to chronicle history as it evolved. And to be able to sit here and look at that wall, to be able to watch this whole night transpire, this is what God destined for me to do, to be a journalist. And this is the place where I would want to be because it's history. And to be able to chronicle it, to be able to talk about it, there is nothing that can replace it. And whenever I listen to my, you know, again, peers and mentors, and they talked about when Joe Louis beat Max Mellon, when they talked about Jackie Robinson breaking the Major League color barrier, when they talked about the I Have a Dream speech, they were there. They talked about it from a historical standpoint. In 30 years, I mean, I'll be 40 years old next Friday, in 30 years, I can have that very same conversation. So there's no place I would rather be than on this set, on this night.
Tara Wall, as you sit here watching this, want to get the whole back panel's reaction, your thoughts?
Well, it is a historic day, certainly. Much congratulations to Barack Obama. I think that certainly for African Americans, history has been made. Whether you agree with him ideologically or not, it is significant. And while many Blacks are having a very proud moment right now in America, I never thought they would see this. We have to remember as well, he is not just a Black president, but the president for all Americans. And whether you're Black, white, rich, poor, Republican, Democrat. So we do have to move forward as a country and support this president and see what he does as a president that's going to represent all Americans.
Paul? Yeah, I'm thinking about Barbara Jordan, one of the great leaders of the civil rights movement. 34 years ago as a congresswoman, she said that when the Constitution was written, it began with we the people, but it left her out. She thought maybe it was by accident, but in truth, that document enslaved her and it insulted her, counting her as three-fifths of a human being. But she concluded in that speech saying, my faith in the Constitution is whole, it is total, it is complete. And tonight reminds me of what Scripture said, that faith is the substance of things hoped for. Well, this has been hoped for by a lot of people for a long time, and people have kept faith with the American dream and that Constitution, even when they were left out of it. And this is a wonderful and powerful night for everybody who believes in the Constitution, the American dream. This is a very cynical age. It's kind of a cynical profession that we're in. You cannot look upon these people and look at the history that's made tonight and be a cynic.
James?
Well, I mean, I grew up in the segregated South. I didn't go to school with African Americans, although where I grew up was overwhelmingly, and it's just hard to overestimate the significance of this event. It's not just another presidential election, and I'm just looking at these people's faces, and I don't blame them. I certainly never thought, obviously later on I did, but as a child, even as a young man, and even sort of middle age, I never thought I'd see this. This is a remarkable thing for this country, and I think it'd make it a big statement about us as a people. I really do.
Remarkable night, and I think a great night for the country. When you think of the great American presidents, they've been transformational men, transformational forces. Whether it's FDR or John F. Kennedy or Ronald Reagan, they're people who took America into a new frontier. And whether it's the Depression or the Cold War,
or today we see new global challenges, security, certainly a new global economic frontier for America. And it seems that America has once again chosen a transformational leader, someone who would take a country that's a little lost and uncertain into the future. A new frontier election, a new frontier president. I think that's what we're seeing tonight. Godspeed.
I got an email from the daughter of Viola Luzzo. I hope I'm pronouncing her name correct. People may not remember, this was a white mother from Michigan who drove down south to try to register African Americans. And she was blown away on the highway by some white supremacists. And clearly we have our pictures and we're showcasing and understandable African Americans. There wasn't any number of whites in this country who walked and who marched and who protested as well. There were folks who raised funds, there were people who gave money, there were people who said that they were not going to raise their children the way they raised them. I think about those white Southern justices, those Fifth Circuit Court of Appeal judges who put into place Brown versus Board of Education. They were disowned by their own friends and family members. So this is not just, I think, a moment for African Americans to celebrate. There were any number of people who wanted to see this day come, who truly wanted to say that, yes, to be an American, whether you're black, white, Hispanic, Asian, whatever, we're all in this together. And so I think they also are celebrating as well, because that family, their mother gave their life, a white mother from Michigan, just like African Americans gave their lives for the right to vote as well.
By the way, I should point out, we're about 2 minutes away from hearing from Senator John McCain, who will be addressing crowds on the grounds of the Biltmore Hotel in Arizona. We, of course, will bring that to you live.
This nation has such elasticity, flexibility. You know, people you talk to abroad can't believe that the country that elected George W. Bush 8 years ago has shifted and is now electing Barack Obama. And they ask, well, how can you do that? And it's because we have an amazing ability in this country to learn, to change, and to give opportunity. And I think that's what's going on here. We've already changed a lot, and I think this is going to really make change come a lot faster in this country now. It's going to speed it up.
I want to go back to the youth question, too, as you look out over that crowd. There are an awful lot of young people in that crowd out there we're looking at now. And this millennial generation does represent fresh hope for the country. And one of the reasons is it is more diverse. 40% of this millennial generation is minority. And they have learned to look beyond gender and race much more than the older generation has. And they hope in a new way. And it's that part of it which I think renews the country as well. It's the fact that people spread up with new ideas, fresh ideas, and fresh hope.
Give the other guy a chance.
And much of this election is not just about Barack Obama tonight. It's about those thousands, hundreds of thousands.
Look at that crowd. That is a remarkable shot right there.
Who have been, you know, working together on the internet, talking to each other, encouraging each other along, forming a community, forming a movement, that he's the leader of the movement. But they really, if this is a bottom-up campaign, and that represents a lot of the hope for the country in the future, because that, if you get that sea of humanity here tonight, Manassas last night, Orlando we saw a couple nights ago, you know, one city after another, that represents sort of an army for change.
I read an essay, I think it was by George Packer from the New Republic, I think it was online today, saying that in the last several days he's seen a heaviness in Barack Obama, a realization that of what lies ahead, that it's no longer just about winning, it's about actually governing.
And the New Yorker, not the New Republic.
Oh, I'm sorry, the New Yorker, yes.
Sorry. You write for them, right?
Yes. But I mean, that is something, whether he has been wrestling, it is something he certainly now has to face.
Absolutely. And that generation has to face it, too.
Sure.
I remember all that generation. So I was old enough in the 60s. This is the best, the most idealistic. No, they weren't. They talked a good game, but when it came to performance, many didn't measure up. We'll see. it's in the testing, and life is a long run. But the one other American figure, I think, who has to be cited tonight is that other Illinoisan who had that burden.
Reverend Jesse Jackson,
Lincoln.
By the way, there.
Well, I was thinking of Lincoln, not Jackson.
No, I'm sorry. I'm showing viewers the picture.
Oh, okay. Right.
I was not adding
in. No.
Yes, but, we have a picture there of Reverend Jackson crying.
But talk about the burdens. Yes, yes. I mean, now comes the job, and I think he knows that.
You know what, Ashley, look at the picture of Reverend Jackson. When we talked about this whole thing during the campaign, it was interesting. It was Reverend Jackson's run in 1998 that created the proportional delegation.
We've got John McCain
that
now
led to this
on stage with Cindy McCain, Sarah Palin, and her husband, Todd. Let's listen in.
Thank you for coming here on this beautiful Arizona evening. My friends, we have come to the end of a long journey. The American people have spoken, and they have spoken clearly. A little while ago, I had the honor of calling Senator Barack Obama to congratulate him. Please. To congratulate him on being elected the next president of the country that we both love. In a contest as long and difficult as this campaign has been, his success alone commands my respect for his ability and perseverance. But that he managed to do so by inspiring the hopes of so many millions of Americans who had once wrongly believed that they had little at stake or little influence in the election of an American president is something I deeply admire and commend him for achieving. This is an historic election, and I recognize the special significance it has for African Americans and for the special pride that must be theirs tonight. I've always believed that America offers opportunities to all who have the industry and will to seize it. Senator Obama believes that too. But we both recognize that though we have come a long way from the old injustices that once stained our nation's reputation and denied some Americans the full blessings of American citizenship, the memory of them still had the power to wound. A century ago, President Theodore Roosevelt's invitation of Booker T. Washington to dine at the White House was taken as an outrage in many quarters. America today is a world away from the cruel and prideful bigotry of that time. There is no better evidence of this than the election of an African American to the presidency of the United States. Let there be no reason now. Let there be no reason now for any American to fail to cherish their citizenship in this, the greatest nation on earth. Senator Obama has achieved a great thing for himself and for his country. I applaud him for it and offer him my sincere sympathy that his beloved grandmother did not live to see this day. Though our faith assures us she is at rest in the presence of her Creator, and so very proud of the good man she helped raise. Senator Obama and I have had and argued our differences, and he has prevailed. No doubt many of those differences remain. These are difficult times for our country, and I pledge to him tonight to do all in my power to help him lead us through the many challenges we face. I urge all Americans. I urge all Americans who supported me to join me in not just congratulating him, but offering our next president our goodwill and earnest effort to find ways to come together, to find the necessary compromises to bridge our differences and help restore our prosperity, defend our security in a dangerous world, and leave our children and grandchildren a stronger, better country than we inherited. Whatever our differences, We are fellow Americans. And please believe me when I say, no association has ever meant more to me than that. It is natural. It's natural tonight to feel some disappointment. But tomorrow, we must move beyond it and work together to get our country moving again. We fought as hard as we could. And though we fell short, the failure is mine, not yours. I am so deeply grateful to all of you for the great honor of your support and for all you have done for me. I wish the outcome had been different, my friends. The road was a difficult one from the outset, but your support and friendship never wavered. I cannot adequately express how deeply indebted I am to you. I'm especially grateful to my wife, Cindy, my children, my dear mother, my dear mother and all my family, and to the many old and dear friends who have stood by my side through the many ups and downs of this long campaign. I have always been a fortunate man, and never more so for the love and encouragement you have given me. You know, campaigns are often harder on a candidate's family than on the candidate, and that's been true in this campaign. All I can offer in compensation is my love and gratitude and the promise of more peaceful years ahead. I am also, of course, very thankful to Governor Sarah Palin, one of the best campaigners I've ever seen. One of the best campaigners I have ever seen, and an impressive new voice in our party for reform and the principles that have always been our greatest strength. Her husband, Todd, and their five beautiful children, for their tireless dedication to our cause and the courage and grace they showed in the rough and tumble of a presidential campaign. We can all look forward with great interest to her future service to Alaska, the Republican Party, and our country. To all my campaign comrades, from Rick Davis and Steve Schmidt and Mark Salter, to every last volunteer who fought so hard and valiantly month after month in what at times seemed to be the most challenged campaign in modern times. Thank you so much. A lost election will never mean more to me than the privilege of your faith and friendship. I don't know what more we could have done to try to win this election. I'll leave that to others to determine. Every candidate makes mistakes, and I'm sure I made my share of them. But I won't spend a moment of the future regretting what might have been. This campaign was and will remain the great honor of my life. And my heart is filled with nothing but gratitude for the experience and to the American people for giving me a fair hearing before deciding that Senator Obama and my old friend, Senator Joe Biden, should have the honor of leading us for the next 4 years. Please, I would not be an American worthy of the name should I regret a fate that has allowed me the extraordinary privilege of serving this country for a half a century. Today, I was a candidate for the highest office in the country I love so much. And tonight, I remain her servant. That is blessing enough for anyone, and I thank the people of Arizona for it. Tonight, tonight, more than any night, I hold in my heart nothing but love for this country and for all its citizens. Whether they supported me or Senator Obama, whether they supported me or Senator Obama, I wish Godspeed to the man who was my former opponent and will be my president. And I call on all Americans, as I have often in this campaign, to not despair of our present difficulties, but to believe always in the promise and greatness of America, because nothing is inevitable here. Americans never quit. We never surrender. We never hide from history. We make history. Thank you, and God bless you, and God bless America. Thank you all very much.
So there he is, a very, very gracious concession speech by Senator McCain. There he is with his wife, Cindy, and the Alaska Governor, Sarah Palin, and her husband, Todd. They are in Phoenix, Arizona right now. They certainly had hoped it wouldn't end like this, but it has. Barack Obama will become the 44th president of the United States, and Joe Biden will become the vice president of the United States. The governors of Illinois and of Delaware will now have to get replacements for both. Joe Biden, among other things, was reelected as senator from Delaware tonight, but he'll be replaced in the U.S. Senate by the governor there, and in Illinois there will be a new senator as well. Both Barack Obama and Joe Biden now will get ready for this transition period between now and January 20th, 2009, when they will be sworn in on the Capitol steps of the United States Congress, and they will become the next president and vice president of the United States. Senator Obama is getting ready to speak to a crowd. He's going to come over to Grant Park. There you see these live pictures from Chicago. He was on the phone earlier. He took Senator McCain's concession call. They spoke. We're told it was a very, very gracious conversation. But now this crowd in Chicago, very different than the crowd we just saw in Phoenix, Arizona at the Biltmore Hotel. There are tens of thousands of people, maybe hundreds of thousands, who have gathered in Grant Park in Chicago to hear from Barack Obama. He will become the next president of the United States. I think it's fair to say, Anderson, that millions and millions of people, not only in the United States, but around the world, and they're watching here on CNN and CNN International in more than 240 countries and territories, they will never forget where they were precisely when it was reported at 11 p.m. on the east coast of the United States, when we reported that Barack Obama will become the president-elect of the United States. It's one of those rare moments people will always remember where they were.
It will be when Barack Obama takes the stage there at Grant Park in front of that crowd, which has been there, has been slowly building throughout the evening, a crowd which more than anything, I think right now, wants to see Barack Obama and his wife and their children and Joe Biden on that stage, as if to confirm what we already know, but just to confirm that Barack Obama will be the next president of the United States. It will be a remarkable moment for those Obama supporters who thought the moment when he accepted the Democratic nomination